Hi everybody, it is Wednesday, September 9. It's good to be back into a midweek video again after a week off. So I have faint memories from my childhood of a dusty flannel wall hanging that my family, my parents, would pull out of a dusty cardboard box each year around Advent. It was a fairly good-sized wall hanging. It was a kind of a dark emerald green color, if I remember correctly. And on it was a brown tree, also cut out of flannel. And on the various branches of this tree were places for different Velcro attachments. These attachments were little flannel cutouts of figures or objects that we were supposed to incrementally attach to the tree or to the ends of the branches. And each of these little attachments referred to a particular Bible story or Bible figure. And each time you'd attach another figure, there would be a Bible passage or a Bible reading to go along with it. So what I'm describing from my childhood is called a Jesse tree. It's kind of like an Advent calendar. It's used the same way. It ties the stories of the Bible together and shows how they lead to Jesus Christ. And it's something you can use during the Advent season. Now, I think that our Jesse tree from my childhood was fairly tattered. I think there were some parts missing, some places where the glue had come undone. I don't really even know how diligent we were about following it over the course of an Advent. But I do remember for at least several consecutive years that that flannel Jesse tree would come out of its box and go on the wall. Just like the Advent candles would come out with the wreath and be placed in the center of our dining room table during the Advent season. And here's why I bring this up. These were holiday traditions, or liturgies, we could call them, that my family used to mark time. And these rituals, and I mean that in a good way, these rituals deepened the memory and the significance of the time we were in, which was Advent. The Jesse tree and the Advent candles set Advent apart. They reminded us this isn't just any time. This is special time. This is how we commemorate and remember what God did for us. Now, God's people have a long history of doing this, engaging in activities to commemorate and remember what God did for them. I was reminded of that again in a passage from Exodus 13 that I read today. Here's what it says. Then Moses said to the people, "Commemorate this day, the day that you came out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery, because the Lord brought you out of it with a mighty hand. Eat nothing containing yeast. Today, in the month of Aviv, you are leaving. When the Lord brings you into the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Hivites, and Jebusites, the land he swore to your ancestors to give you, a land flowing with milk and honey, you are to observe this ceremony in this month. For 7 days, eat bread made without yeast, and on the seventh day, hold a festival to the Lord. Eat unleavened bread during those 7 days. Nothing with yeast in it is to be seen among you, nor shall any yeast be seen anywhere within your borders. On that day, tell your son, I do this because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt. This observance will be for you like a sign on your hand and a reminder on your forehead that this law of the Lord is to be on your lips. For the Lord brought you out of Egypt with his mighty hand. You must keep this ordinance at the appointed time, year after year." See, God's people mark time not just with the chronology of a calendar, January, February. God's people mark time according to the memory of God's actions and of God's faithfulness. God's people engage in practices that don't just remember what God did, they bring that action of God into the present tense. God delivered you from slavery. You do this year after year because you're still living in that deliverance. Or, like churches practice at communion or the Lord's Supper, take, eat, remember, and believe the blood and the body given for the complete forgiveness of all your sins, because you're still living in that forgiveness, bringing the memory of God's action into the present tense of God's action today. And these practices also have a teaching aspect. Maybe you heard that. They reinforce our memory, but they're also an opportunity to pass on the story. Moses tells the people that when they observe the feast of unleavened bread, they should say to their children, "I do this because of what the Lord did for me." It's a teaching moment, an opportunity to pass on the story of God's deliverance. Just like later when the people of Israel passed through the Jordan River, they set up these stones as monuments, and then Joshua, their leader by that time, says, "In the future, when your children ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' tell them the story. Talk about how God parted the waters of the Jordan and miraculously led this people into this land." So these practices or these monuments are a reminder, and they're also an opportunity to teach, to tell the story of God's faithfulness. What this means for us is that there should be practices, behaviors, symbols in our lives about what God has done for us. Maybe even things that cause children or other people to ask, "Hey, what's that for?" And we say, "It reminds me of what God did for me." Maybe this could be a kind of Advent practice in the home. Maybe it's some sort of Lent observation. Maybe it's a kind of Sabbath observance or other faith habit or practice, something in your life that's different, that stands out, that you do because it reminds you of what God did for you. See, these external signs and practices remind us and teach others of God's love. So, here's the question I want to leave us with. Where in our lives can we include or continue something that makes us say, "I do this because of what the Lord has done for me"? Have a great week, and we'll see you again next time.